following content contains discussion or description of violence against women, racism, ableism, and sexual assault. If these are subjects that make you uncomfortable, it may be best to skip this show entirely. Simply walk away knowing the Joss Whedon show Dollhouse is likely to set off any number of triggers. Don't watch it.
Who's that girl?
Welcome to the Echo Chamber, podcast Joss Whedon, fuck my life. Jesus.
Dollhouse, we love it. We love Dollhouse in this film.
Last time, or the time before, I don't remember, I said, fuck, they're trying to do things now, so we actually have something new to talk about, and I hate it, I hate it. I hate it.
So much badness.
It's so annoying.
We're in the bad place.
Also, gonna confess right here on the air, not ashamed to admit it. About halfway through, I turned it on to 2x speed again. I was like, this is so plotting. The pacing of this episode is misery. Because it's like, how... It's the same length, but it drags on for so much longer, and given the content, that makes it worse.
Yeah, no, like, the first time I watched this, like, I want to say maybe, like, a third of the way through, I was like, I can start sorting magic cards and watch this. I don't need to take notes. There's nothing to note on this.
Yeah, no, it just like, there's so many points in this episode where it just kinda, like, drags its feet and is like, I'm almost there. See where I'm headed? It's like, yeah, I see where you're headed. Everything that you are doing right now has been brought up before.
You know, they had to stop and pull out the plot roadmap to check for directions.
Yeah.
I think I described it to, because a friend of mine I talked to about the show, they're like a huge Buffy fan, but they hate Joss Whedon. So they've been, I've been telling them as I watch the episodes, like, oh my god, this episode is really bad. This time I went, this is an episode from a different show that got Frankenstein spliced into Dollhouse and is somehow worse than, like, half of the Dollhouse episodes, just by proxy of being not even. Like, a couple of these episodes, I can come back and be like, you know, I kind of saw what they were trying to go for here. Here it's just like, why? What? Who? Why?
Well, I mean, this episode... Whereas, last episode, you know, last season, we had Echoes, which is the episode where we got to meet Caroline. Well, this is just that, but for someone else. So let's see here.
Episode.
We don't need to do the usual thing of figuring out which plot to talk about first.
No. Our usual thing to do first is... Mix.
Yes.
Do you have anything to say about... Is there anything about the production of this episode that leads in to what we're about to talk about?
Okay, so, first things first. The writers. It's Marissa Tancheroen and her husband, Jed Whedon! It's Joss's brother again!
Yay!
And I'm going to just say now, you may have noted two co-hosts and anyone watching the show because of the podcast. Why are you doing that? I know there are people that do now. Why did you do that? The song in the middle of the episode, the really weird out of place, like indie folk song.
Uh-huh.
That's them. They wrote and performed that just for this episode. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my god, that sucks!
It does! It's so bad!
God. Yeah, that's... Also, didn't they do that before?
Yes, they did one in season one, too.
They sure fucking did.
I think it was on the Pop Star episode? I could be wrong on that one. Also, this is an episode that was sent out to critics before the season aired.
They view it as a serious, important one, yeah.
This is the one that people were talking about.
This and the next one, which we haven't watched yet. Those two were sent out as like a package deal. The reason I bring that up is we have another letter from Joss that he wrote himself to give to the reviewer.
Yeah.
Oh, but I still haven't gotten over the shock of having this incredibly soft T-shirt.
Don't.
It's so T-shirt.
Don't worry. This one's a lot shorter. It's only one paragraph this time.
T-shirt.
It's more like a blog. It's a tweet, basically. We're back with two brand new, never before sent to reviewers episodes of Dollhouse, the show that's sweeping an unbelievably tiny portion of the nation. This is the year we all just get to have fun, twist the premise, go darker, further, sillier, make the whole world our dollhouse. Ugh, that's a bad phrase. It's a party and you're the first to arrive, which means the food's not ready and we're not dressed. And who shows up to a party on time anyway, losers? I mean best friends ever, .. We really hope you enjoy these, .. Thanks, and see you on TiVo, as if this wasn't 2009 enough.
It's not. It's still 90s.
TiVo, the most 90s portion of the late.
Yeah, that's 2000s. True, actually. That's fair.
I also like that the trivia section on the wiki is just like, yeah, Paul Ballard's not in this episode. And it took that for me to go, huh, he wasn't in this episode. Wow.
He wasn't in this episode.
I didn't even notice. Shows how much he contributes.
Yeah, no. Honestly, my brain feels a little lighter knowing that. Because it's like, oh.
He still got credit because he's in the show, but like.
Sure. Yeah. No, that's just what shows do. But.
Huh. Yeah.
I'm glad he wasn't. It would have been even worse if he was there.
Probably, yeah. I don't know how, but.
Yeah, because he is a fucking annoying, moralizing character who adds intrigue where we don't need it.
But.
Like, his. The whole intrigue that Ballard. That the perspective of Paul Ballard provides to this show is super unnecessary.
Well,
it's like, it's never been necessary. We've never needed him. We've never needed anything that he's done. We've never needed anybody. He was basically just a vehicle for Alpha to drive into the dollhouse, fuck shit up, and then leave, and is now just a vehicle for Echo to be the lady who's not quite Echo and not quite Caroline. Well, like, that's all he is!
Well, don't worry. Echo's barely in the episode, too.
You know? She could have been in it less.
Mm.
I have one more thing before we start talking about the episode proper, and that is, I just want to say the first part of one of the main reviews that, like, you know, critics had for this, from New York Magazine. They called this a genuinely radical feminist plotline.
Yeah, they did! It is radical. It's a radical in the sense that it is an outlier of the extremist sense. It's just on the not feminist side of the scale. But this was the time. This was the time that everybody was, like, sucking that Joss Whedon feminism dick. Like, that's why he thought he could tell a crowd of women that feminism needed to be rebranded. Like,
yeah.
That's why he got away with that. It's because he was a big fucking deal feminist thinker. And the shitty pop culture brain weekend warrior feminists of the time absolutely wanted a man that they could shove out there and be like, yeah, he's saying it. Because that is what Whedon feminism was. Whedon feminism was just a gross attempt, was just like a disgusting way for people who were too obsessed with pop culture to create apologetics for the fact that the pop culture that they were worshiping blatantly contributed to the very problems that feminism exists to address. And that is why I have a book called Weedonistas about a whole bunch of shitty, like, barely, like, a bunch of shitty fantasy writers who, like, spend most of their time on Goodreads bullying children and patting themselves on the back for being published authors. And that's because that's who they all are. I looked it up.
I would make a joke that the Weedonistas thing would be a Patreon exclusive if we had a Patreon, but...
Yeah, no, don't worry. I'm hurting myself for this. I may as well hurt myself for that, with that, too. It's the way Joss Whedon would like it.
Yeah. Speaking of hurting for Joss Whedon's benefit.
Okay. Frank, go ahead and give us our quick and dirty synopsis of this episode.
First,
so
I actually have
talk about it.
A fun thing. I'm doing the Mix thing of bringing in a production note that I'm surprised Mix didn't pick up. Because I watched this episode last week.
Yay!
And I went to go just sort of jog my memory on some of the details. And so I ended up on a wiki page which informed me that the director was one Mr. Jonathan Frakes.
From
Riker from Star Trek, yeah.
Riker?
Oh, well, that would be because I saw the name and went, huh, don't know who that is. Because I'm not a Star Trek fan.
Well known and liked, but I guess a little less liked by me now. So he directed this one.
Consider, so the time period was this moment where, like, being sort of like the there was like a nerd brat pack that was making its way around, and like you had your Neil Patrick Harris, your Will Wheaton, you had a couple of others. Jonathan Frakes never quite made the level, but he was up there. So it makes sense that he was in this circle.
He was in this circle.
It makes sense that
I can tell you, Star Trek, The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, to a certain extent, Voyager had a little thing that they did where they took their actors and some of their other set people and trained them on how to write or direct if they were interested. And as a result, several of them that kind of took to directing just, like, direct a whole bunch of random episodes of TV here and there because they just felt like doing it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm looking...
I'm also saying that...
It looks like he was also randomly directing stuff in Leverage and Castle around this time, too.
Yes, and sure. And which also, there were a lot of names in this show that were, like, that we found in, those shows of the time. What I am saying is, 2009 was a special point where everybody who had ever done a funny guest star on Futurama were now, like, sort of nerd royalty. And...
Oh, so they showed up on King of the Nerds.
he was among the outer circle of that. That's not to say anything for or against him, just that he was, by merit of being, like, a Star Trek guy at the time when being... a Star Trek guy that, like, talked to fans was a very, like, public and noticeable thing, was just there during it. So
yeah, this was the before times, before anyone could at anyone on Twitter and yell.
Yeah, no, exactly. It's not like I think he was hanging out with Joss Whedon or anything. I'm just saying I understand how he got here, like, specifically. It's the same way that fucking Patton Oswalt and Felicia Day got here. Like, it's because they were all they were nerds of note at a time when nerds of note were being shoved into a spotlight that they, some of them did well with, and most of them didn't do well with. and I would say Jonathan Frakes lands squarely in did fine. Did just fine. He did fine. He's fine.
He's fine.
I mean, it's not like he wrote the episode, so, you know.
Yeah, no, yeah. No.
Yeah, I suppose the directing of this episode isn't the problem.
I'm sure he got some notes from the fans. But okay, now. Sorry about that. Go for it, Frank.
Anyways, the plot of this fucking episode. Remember in season one where they let all the dolls do a walkabout and they all went to, like, fulfill their secret needs? And how we learned that Sierra's was, like, going and confronting this doctor who had abused her and then put her in the dollhouse?
Because he was rich and powerful.
Yeah, and he was rich and powerful and stuff. So this episode's just about that.
Yeah, it sure is. This episode's
just the Sierra episode, and it's circling back around to that.
It is another chance for us to go, hey, Sierra's a rape victim.
Mm-hmm.
Let's watch.
It's just one plot line. We're not going to have to do the probably confusing to the listener thing of jumping between plot lines, even though chronologically they get all smushed around. It's just one long suffering.
Do you think this would have been better or worse if they hadn't already in season one, like, revealed it? Like, if we didn't know her deal?
I don't think it matters because we learned so much more about it. And it's not quite what it was implied to be anyway.
Yeah, no, yeah, it is actually, the thing is that it is simultaneously more faithful than I expected it to be, and also more revisionist than I expected it to be. Like, there were parts of it that I was like, yeah, that is what they said then. That's weird that they apparently remembered that. Oh, but then they didn't remember this, what the fuck?
Mm-hmm. So, like, I guess what I would say is this might as well not be a follow-up to anything. It might as well be fresh, because we don't...
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that it happened before at all!
In the end, it didn't even matter.
Speaking of 90s. this show is so persistently 90s! I don't get it!
Because Joss Whedon was persistently 90s. And again, in a time when that was what everybody wanted.
Yeah, the flashbacks, when we see Sierra's name is Priya, as we knew. When we see her before, A, I didn't realize that she came after both Echo and Victor, not to get ahead, but, like, learning that was, like, the biggest reveal.
Yeah, also, the reveal in the episode starts with 1 year ago, and we see Sierra
it's 1 year
as Priya.
Ago in the 90s.
Yeah, so apparently this entire season one and all of season two so far have taken place in less than a year, because Sierra was already there.
Well, because we know Echo's like 2 years into her thing.
That's insane!
No, but the first episode is her first day.
Christ, is it?
They tell Echo that she has a new friend.
Yeah. And so
it's been exactly a year.
Okay. Christ. It's just insane that, like, I don't know. Time frames, they're stupid. Along with everything else, it's all stupid.
It is all stupid.
So, the episode starts with a blurry, shot of Topher saying, I was trying to help her. And then, that's it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like, oh, flash forward.
Yeah, but he says it twice. And, like, the effect makes you think, are they trying to make us think that they're repeating? That he's, like, are they, like, that they're repeating the line? But no, he actually just says it twice, and they hold on him for, like, an awkwardly long amount of time.
Yeah, and it's all blurry, and he's got blood on him, maybe, but it's kind of hard to see because it's all blurry, and it's like, whoa, what happened? I guess we'll have to wait till the end of the episode to find out why Topher's covered in blood, saying he just wanted to help Sierra. Did Sierra die? Oh, no! She does.
No, she doesn't. It's really stupid.
And then we get a flashback to the 90s where Priya and unnamed black woman are selling art?
Yeah, Priya. Yeah, they're selling art on the boardwalk of some beach, probably the LA beach.
I say art. They very obviously just like grabbed shit from a thrift store for the props.
A thrift store, or like a some of it's from a thrift store. Some of it's from like a Ross. It's from Ross.
Yeah, it's.
Dress for Less, where you can also buy random discounted knickknacks. It's stuff that you see in the out of the corner of your eye when you are buying literally anything else.
But the scene is pretty thin. It's just the guy who we saw from season one. Nolan, I think his name is.
Yeah, Nolan. Nolan Kinnard.
He's apparently been like coming to buy her stuff for a while now. The black woman, who again is not named, we'd never see her again.
No, she's just like her. They both have their stall set next to each other, and she's like, "Oh, you're helping me sell my jewelry because you're an Aussie princess." And then she's like, your jewelry sells itself. And something catty language there, you know, the friends who swear at each other or whatever, you know.
She also lets it slip that she doesn't have a work visa. Which, nothing ever comes of that, actually. So it's just a random detail that someone decided had to be part of her character.
It does help make her predicament more predicament-y, so...
That is true. It does make her into more of a victim. You're right.
Yes. So it does something for somebody, by which I mean...
I mean, boing.
Joss Whedon. Yeah, boing.
Boing.
Yay, the doll has to possibly an immigrant in. Whoopee.
I will say that the stores across the way are Charlie Temmel Ice Cream, Medical Marijuana the Doctor is In, and Botox on the Beach.
LA, am I right?
Yeah, like that doesn't, and then just a big sign for toe rings. So like,
LA, am I right?
Again, why is it the 90s?
Jesus Christ. I mean, okay, that is a little bit, LA. California is tacky as hell. But.
Anyway, he basically, not so subtly, implies that he wants to hook up with her, but is like,
He wants to own her. She asks what it is, like, he comes up to her, acts super fucking weird, and the black lady's just like, ooh, girl, you hooked one, and it's like, what? This guy's fucking unhinged, and it's really obvious. And then she's like, what is it you want? Because he asks for, he wants to commission work, and he's like, I want you to make something for me.
Wink.
Like, what the fuck? That is a caricature of a crazy person, and they are both just like, yeah, this seems legit.
Well, no, Priya isn't like that. Priya hates it.
She goes with it enough because she's like, well, I do need the money, so it's probably okay to go with this crazy man and like do work for him.
We get a scene transition to, I guess, like the future, but still a year ago.
Probably like a week.
Took her a week to. I mean, I hired her to paint a huge painting. Then, like, that's installed in his place. But
yeah, that's true. Hey, wait, we're back to less than a year ago.
We get the first shot of this painting she made, which is like, it's fine. It's like birds and a million patterns.
Yeah, no, I mean, it is. I've absolutely seen it at my dentist office. It's fine.
Very Pier 1 import score, I'll say that.
Yeah, that's the one I was groping for. Thank you.
And this is where we see Echo and Victor here for some reason.
Yeah.
Why are they here?
Yeah, so there's a whole party happening that
with a bunch
to like
of
show
rich
off her
phonies.
Art. Yeah, it's to show off her art, but like also it's really to try and like impress upon her like you could be part of the lifestyle of the rich and famous.
Yeah, because apparently Nolan used through his connections to the dollhouse as some kind of microbiology whiz kid mastermind he's not a kid, but like medical guy uses his connections to the dollhouse to arrange this party so that Victor and Echo can like heavily suggest that she should hook up with him.
I think Echo might just be coincidence because we very obviously see her walking off with another guy. Like in the camera, like shows her walking off with him.
She's part of the party's window dressing, but she's not specifically. Yeah, maybe.
But well, no, because the guy that they're with shows up later. I think he's the guy.
Well, yeah, but I mean, like she's there to make it look like there's somebody else at the party that isn't crazy, and then she goes off on her own thing, and like then Priya and Victor really have like a pointed conversation, which is more like, oh, this is, Victor's the one that's supposed to be priming the pump. Yeah?
No, I was gonna say, like, well, considering she sees him and goes, you seem normal, do you want to get out of here, please? Like, immediately.
Uh-huh. You seem normal. What the fuck? Because they're also flirting, like, except Victor is supposedly supposed to be, like, being, like, gaining trust so that he can boost Nolan, but Priya's just like, no, I'm into this guy.
Yeah, and then he's like, okay,
and he doesn't
because
even, like,
they're
really
destined to be together, get it?
Like, he doesn't even really talk the guy up at all, he's just like, okay, well.
He very weakly mentions, as she's like, let's just leave, he very weakly goes, okay, we can go somewhere and I can tell you more about Nolan, and like, that's it. But that's how we're supposed
yet,
to
no.
know he's... Huh?
He's sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. He's mostly there to try and be like, I'm a rich art seller, so if you get with Nolan, you'll have connections like me,
a
rich art seller who can make you famous because your art is so good.
Yeah. Because, like, I mean, you know. And we know this is, we know for a fact what this is because Nolan and Mr. and old guy from Rossum, like, have a whole bunch of exposition talk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they walk off on their own, and the old guy's like, we could just make you a doll, and...
I don't want a doll. I want her.
Mm-hmm.
He sits with this crazy person edge. I love it. How fucking...
And yeah.
They're crazy people are just so cartoonishly crazy.
Yeah, and like he ends up like making a huge ass scene where like basically physically assaults her in front of God and everybody. And
yeah,
just kind of like stares like, huh, that's weird.
And yeah, also in this scene, Echo briefly talks to Priya / Sierra. And Echo is there to just be like, oh, you know, like wow. You're really beautiful, and, like, who even cares if you love Nolan or not? You should stick with him, and,
yeah,
like...
No, because she's saying, like, yeah, there's a... You know what's so great about this room? There's so much power in it. Like, there's a lot of money, but that's not power. Nolan's medical genius, short-lives for the Nobel, that's power. Art, that's power. They can't make it, so they want it. So, really, you have the power.
An incredible restraint to not say pussy power.
She's going on the girl boss approach. And I guess, like, Victor's doing the gaslighting, and that's why Nolan has to gatekeep by grabbing by grabbing Priya as she's trying to leave and slamming her into the door. And then as he's about to do the thing that's like, oh, ooh, ha, 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 like brush it off like it was an accident or something, he just leans in and is like, how did you think this was going to go? I like, and it's just like, oh, so he just continues to say crazy guy things at her. And it doesn't matter to anybody or anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, no, the whole party, like, looks, but, like, only kind of. And I guess a lot of them are actives, but not all of them, so I don't know.
I mean, I don't I know that I wouldn't expect any of them to, like, rush to her aid because they're all here for a reason. But, like, seriously, the way that everybody reacts.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, you're mine, and...
You've been seducing me, just dangling in front of me day after day, and she's like, no.
And then he, like, and then she, like, gets away from him, and she's like, nothing in this world could ever make me love you. Cut to... present day. Where we see Sierra coming up to Nolan and kissing him. And saying and talking all sweetly to him, and she's off to work or wherever. And oh, forgot to say, Priya did take a picture of Victor while they were at the party with this ridiculous bedazzled Polaroid camera.
Yeah, that's like her thing. She uses that.
And so when she leaves, Nolan. Tells her to, oh, wait, and he grabs the camera, and her camera, and takes a picture of her, and then as it develops, he, like, stares at her angrily as she's leaving, and he tosses it into a drawer that's just filled with other, with, like, every other, Polaroid picture of every single, like, time that he's brought her.
Have you gotten the message yet that this man is crazy?
Did you notice this man's, like, fucking crazy? I wonder if the dollhouse is bad. Maybe they should... I hope that in this episode they tell me at some point the dollhouse might be bad.
I don't know. I think it does a lot of good.
Well, they're trying to help, after all. We heard it from Topher.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So yeah, then the credits happen, and it's like, woo, buckle up, everybody. The Sierra Trauma Parade is about to begin.
Woo! I think it's more of a roller coaster than a parade at this point.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I probably meant roller coaster, but whatever. Anyway!
So that all was prologue of just, like, that's how Sierra got into the dollhouse. It was... Well, sort of. We still don't know all of it by this point, is the thing. We still have to wait until later to understand the specifics, but...
Yeah, because it's not enough, you see. Mm-hmm. We could have inferred it as people who have watched season one, which I know that isn't actually a lot of people when this aired, but as people who actually watched season one, we can infer that, in fact, this is probably just the lead-up to Sierra being brought to the dollhouse. But that's not enough. We need more!
Yeah, no, and also, it's just the season 2 promise that every episode will start with abuse right off the bat, so... that's like the season 2 guarantee
that's
that we're bringing
Joss Whedon
in.
That's the Joss Whedon standard.
Also, two dings, by the way. One is for Sierra being manipulated into, like, the relationship by the party full of dolls and stuff... And also because we know that Nolan is the abuser from before. And then another ding, which is, like, when that doesn't work for him, he then menaces her and then, like, turns her into a doll anyway. So that's how it is.
And physically slams her into the door.
Very much also just, like, physically assaulted.
Yes.
Yeah, no, there's also just the overt assault.
Yeah, no, I think I counted that with the entire party. At some point in these notes, I note that it's really hard to make discrete sort of notes of abuse in this episode because it's just kind of one long rolling boulder of abuse.
Hmm. Yeah,
it's hard to chunk it up. I did my best.
Really, the only time abuse isn't happening is when Sierra's not on screen. Which is
and when Sierra's not on screen, you should be asking, why aren't we abusing Sierra?
Also, I do just want to point out that the other reason the party scene exists is so that they can show that Victor and Sierra genuinely fall in love at first sight, even when he was inactive and she...
Yeah, you know, that's fucking weird. I don't know why that's what they're going for, but they are. And
they're just like faded lovers, even though that's not the kind of story this show is usually.
See, the wiki that I'm using is... It tries to write it off as, oh, he understands and shares her artistic passion, and that's why she's interested. It's like, that's...
Oh, man!
That's, buddy, that's written the by active... Written by a weedanista. That's the active persona. I don't think Victor the person is doing that.
No, we're supposed to believe that across time and space, Victor... Sierra... I mean, sorry, Priya and... What was Victor's name?
He didn't get a name.
Do we know? Yeah. Oh, no. His real name.
No. I mean his real name.
No, we don't.
Who he was.
We don't.
I don't think
okay.
we know.
Okay. We don't know anything about him yet.
We know one thing.
And a thing that gets confirmed in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, his cover identity is Anthony Sassoli. Why does this have a... It doesn't matter. This...
Yeah.
Back in the dollhouse, it's art time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what Sierra's drawing?
Twitter.
Yeah. She's drawing birds.
It's birds. With
Yeah, she still draws birds, but it's like child's watercolor bird now.
Yeah, but it's also she doesn't like the color that she's using because she's painting it black now. She painted a bird and now she's painting a big black mark all over the page. And Echo and Victor are like, aw. Except Victor is like, aw. And Echo is like,
ew.
And they're like, why do you use the color if you don't like it? And she's, it's always here.
Always here.
Just a little look into her twisted mind.
Fuck.
So Victor and Echo both have some thoughts on how to handle this situation, because I guess Victor is also developing conscious through life.
I guess, or not, and that's just what he's like, because it's not like they've ever elaborated on anything.
So Victor focuses on the color black. Echo grabs the painting and goes to Topher, non-subtle.
Yeah!
Because I guess Topher's...
Oh, there is one thing happening here that I think is supposed to tie into a larger arc where Topher is working on something that isn't working, but it should work because Alpha got it. Alpha got
thing.
It to work. Alpha got it to work through a phone.
Yeah, and he starts talking to himself.
Mm-hmm. And he says, well, you are talking to yourself, and so maybe you are crazy.
And just then he's like, oh, wait a minute. Like, something occurs to him, but then the plot of this episode happens, so he stops thinking about that altogether.
I guess that 30 seconds might be the B plot of this episode.
I did unfortunately have one thought partway through one of Topher's monologues in this episode where I went, shit, I say things like that sometimes. Do I sound like Topher? Like, I had that unfortunate realization that would just weigh on me for the rest of the episode.
Aww.
But in any case, she gives him the painting and says, Sierra painted it. He's like, okay, cool. Thanks, I guess. Joke about fridge that I didn't bother writing down.
I don't have any space on my fridge.
Somehow Echo is like, he's connecting the blackness to the black
Not
painting.
Not somehow. Echo is... fully aware, and she's pretending, she's trying to dumb herself down in a way that makes Topher go, oh, maybe something's wrong with Sierra. Why is this allowed to happen?
What I'm saying is, how does Echo know about, what's his name?
Yes,
she wouldn't. I guess she just figures out that
yeah.
there's some guy who makes her upset. Also, she is just allowed in the lab. She just walks up behind him.
I think they're all allowed. They just almost never
do. Oh, wait a minute. No, there's a thing that we see in this episode. Is that written down?
What?
Sierra's
thing. Oh, yeah. I think... No, it's not. It's not.
Okay. All right. So no, she has no way of knowing.
Yeah.
She just fucking. So you're absolutely right, Nyx. She absolutely. Even though like they try to bait and switch you by being like but Echo is remembering everything, so now she's trying to act up whatever. But no, you're absolutely right. She has no way of knowing what's going on. Just that Sierra's being weird.
Like the fact that something's wrong with Sierra, that totally makes sense. But a bad man. Coming out of it literally comes out of nowhere.
She's like the bad. Sierra doesn't call him the bad man. Like at least we didn't see it.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
But I guess this is enough for Topher to go. Okay, sounds good. I'll look into it. And he actually does, which is uncharacteristic for Topher.
Yeah, which is commented on several times in this episode.
This episode, half of it is just the rest of the cast looking at Topher going. That's out of your character. Why are you doing that? So we get the conversation with Boyd. Boyd is, like, weirdly menacing in this episode. Like,
yeah.
The whole time.
To be fair, he has been his characterization has been weird this whole season so far. It's just he hasn't been on screen that much.
Also, hey, just a point in general. Every other thing that Sierra is asked to do, she doesn't leave a bad impression. So, all the other rape that she's forced to engage with is fine.
Well, yeah, also. but that's because that's not the... Well, she didn't have... That wasn't her trauma from before. So yeah. Why would it matter?
Why would anything matter?
It would only matter if it was Echo, because Echo's the one retaining.
Mm-hmm. And I would imagine a part of it might also be Topher is convinced that, like, it's... Because Topher apparently doesn't know that Echo's remembering anything still. So, from his perspective, he might just legitimately think, oh, well, she doesn't remember, so it can't be that.
Yeah, so Topher goes to this room, which is just, like, filled with monitors... And
I guess it's Boyd's office, but it's literally like the backwards.
I think it's like a security room because Boyd has an office proper with a desk, but like I guess it's like some sort of like security database computer room or something. It's a map or something. And he asks Boyd about Nolan because Boyd shows up and is like, "What are you doing?" And Topher explains the whole thing. Boyd tries to say, "Wait, Echo brought it to you?" Wait, Echo said what? but Topher keeps interrupting him with more information on what it turns out on Nolan. And then he refers to the needs episode from last season. Which I think is a bad move, because you shouldn't make us remember the specifics of that episode if you're going to only get half of it right.
Yeah, so for those that don't remember, because I guess, it has been a little bit, that was the episode where they remembered everything with their own ways, and we got, like, glimpses at everyone that wasn't Echo's whole deal. And that was Sierra. She confronted him, but, like, didn't get a chance to, like, actually, like, try and kill him, from what I remember.
She just had to confront him, and then, it was just over?
Yeah, I think he called Dollhouse and had them come get her. But
fuck, yeah, I'm remembering more plot holes in that episode. And once again, they shouldn't bring our attention back to something that they're going to just ineptly refer to.
But we find out from here that Topher mentions that he remembers when she first came, she had been listed as a paranoid schizophrenic who's ready to misunderstand mental illness.
Yay! Mm-hmm.
Woo! Yay! So what Yippee! Happens is, yeah.
We don't get the flashback yet. That's
no. It's not the flashback yet. But what we get here is Topher and Boyd talk about it, and Boyd is like, "So what? What do you want me to do, basically, about it?" And Topher's like, "But there's something here. There's something here." And Boyd is like, "Saunders, she would have saw a pattern." So I guess that prompts Topher to go to Dr. Saunders' files?
Well, I mean, because she seems to have left and, like, left all of her stuff behind.
Yes, but, like, she's going through these files and he's going through her files, but also has, like, six other pictures that Sierra has painted that are all a bird and, like, a smear of black. And it's like, when did...
Yeah,
this is a weird thing. This is a weird thing to just have.
Yeah, like, you would think that, that she would have brought it up before now if, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, obviously she probably did bring it up at some point and everybody told her to shut the fuck up because they don't like her and they think she's stupid and she should just get back to doing doctor work. But, like, it's still just sort of weird to me that there's this, like, this suggests to me that in a file in a drawer, she just has there's just a folder marked Sierra that says, that's just got a bunch of large, like, warped, paint-covered sheets crammed into it with a bunch of meticulously written notes about, well, as Topher reads, about how they all seem to point towards a resentment and hatred of Topher.
I mean, which is a fair explanation, considering Topher.
Yeah, but then Topher says, "I'm not the bad man."
I'm not the bad man.
Sorry, my brain just did once learn how bad me be with Topher. Anyway, I'm gonna die. I'm gonna die now.
Fit perfectly into it. Fuck.
Yeah. Yeah.
God damn it.
The Topher.
No!
The Topher.
No!
Oh, I'm really tempted to change that Discord name. But I think that's too painful.
Also, now I guess it's probably the best time as I need to mention I did find something out. Why Whiskey just sort of says, "Okay, bye," and vanishes for most of, possibly all of the season? Apparently she was filming another show and just straight up was like, "I'm doing this other show." ABC's Happy Town. I don't know what that show is.
That sounds... I'm thinking of a different show. Never mind.
Wow.
I don't know that show either.
I don't imagine it was that successful, but like...
No, it did... wow. It did bad enough...
Happy Town. The last... Don't let the name fool you. Sorry. That's a real good fucking tagline. You really nailed it.
Oh. Wow. It looks like it did bad enough that the last two episodes didn't air.
Woof.
Woof.
I'm going to say this much, though. I bet that there was a stipend to start a contract for a new show that was worth more than sitting in Dollhouse.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how bad a show is. When you're in production, you're getting your paycheck from forwarded money that you've agreed upon beforehand. So I'm just going to go out on a limb here and say that's probably why. I can't imagine Dollhouse was offering that much. They have a reduced budget.
Yeah.
So I would probably walk to a different piece of shit too if it meant I could have more piece of shit money up front.
And, you know, not working with Whedon.
Yeah.
So. Also a plus.
Maybe like, not a bullet you knew you were dodging at the time, but definitely,
Yeah, definitely an, ooh, yeah, oops, glad I made the right call.
In any case, this is enough for Topher to be like, I need to dig further into this. Meanwhile, Victor is heisting all of the black paint he can find. Mm-hmm. God bless him. Victor continues to be the best part of the show.
God, this adorable, stupid little puppy dog of a man.
Yeah. But Boyd notices that Echo is, like, actively helping him do this instead of just, like,
blindly. Because Echo decides that what a good idea is to, in front of the dollhouse in the world, like, just tell Victor that not only was he doing a good thing, but that he's doing a proactive thing. And she's like trying to radicalize him. Like,
wow, I can't believe that Echo's becoming base.
And I mean, Boyd is just like, what the hell?
Yeah,
it's like, Boyd, where have you been?
What are you up to, girl, is what he says.
What are you up to, girl?
Like, she's a sheep wandering away.
And then I said, the same thing she's been up to the whole time! It's just that we know that she's deciding to do it now, as opposed to when it was just happening because before.
From here, though, we get a scene with, this is the scene with Boyd and Topher that we can basically skip. It's just Topher.
Topher says brain stuff.
Yeah, Topher jargons for a minute.
We do get to see the back rooms briefly, where Topher goes and gets Priya's original imprint.
He does go to the back rooms.
So the back rooms are real. The back rooms!
I'm so sorry, Dollhouse. You would have done numbers 10 years later.
I guess in the absence of Manicotti Millie existing, the back rooms is my new favorite character. And I'm now happy when I see the back rooms.
But yeah, he determines through that she wasn't paranoid schizophrenic. She was just pretend, like,
She was drugged into looking like she was paranoid schizophrenic.
But later on, we also find out she's been conscious the whole time, so I don't know how that works.
Also that this is something that just sort of slipped by when she came in. If it's so obvious, Mister, I put a brain with some yellow spray paint on it next to another brain with yellow spray paint on it, and went, "Oh my god, it's just drugs." Like,
also, like, I probably will bring this up again because this comes up again more thoroughly later. But the whole idea is like Topher thought he was helping Priya by turning into an active because she was schizophrenic, and he was effectively curing that by wiping her brain.
Uh-huh.
Hey, that's not a cure. It's not okay to wipe a brain. It doesn't suddenly become immoral to wipe a brain because, oh, she wasn't really crazy. It was immoral when she was also schizophrenic. That was still immoral.
Like, I'm gonna be real. Topher is stupid enough that I unironically believe. He probably thinks that, like, oh yeah, you had mental illness. That's why we got you. We'll fix that when you get let loose again, as if that's ever going to happen and that's how things work.
Like, he doesn't. I mean, they do let people go. Contracts come up and people leave! But I don't think they have the ability to make
it. We've seen it happen once, and that was a special circumstance. They've never shown us any other actions.
Yeah, well, that's because they don't show us anything. Adele's talked about it like it's real.
And given this episode, I think that Adele is guileless enough that she would absolutely be referring to something real. But that's all beside the point. The point here is,
this better have been
a ding. The point here is that, yeah, ding, Topher decided that Topher's reasoning for why Sierra becoming a doll was good was because he was going to clean her brain.
Mm-hmm.
The squeegee.
But it turns out, oops, it was the brain that somebody else made all dirty to begin with. Which I again ask, if you quote-unquote fixed her schizophrenia, which is not what that is, but how did you not see that?
It was a year ago. Topher was very stupid a year ago.
Oh, yeah, he was still baby.
That's well, true. Remember, a year ago was the 90s, so he's technically like...
We were all fucked up in the 90s. There were too many animated, colorful squiggles bouncing around him for him to be able to tell.
I'm going to quote the wiki here again, because it says, in a previously uncharacteristic surge of ethical concern, Topher tells Boyd. Even the wiki's like, huh, that's a little weird for him.
Yeah, but the thing is that the episode is also saying it, and it's like, it starts with Boyd. It starts with Boyd being like, oh, and that worried you? And it's like, yeah, okay, you've said this before.
The whole episode, everyone's like, we got you because you weren't supposed to have any morals. And I'm just sitting here like, this would have been a much funnier show if they had hired him and he had morals the whole time. He was just very confused about everything. Like, if Topher was a different character, this would be a better show. But you know, in this specific way.
Topher, we'll get to it.
Yeah.
I have words to say about that scene. We'll get to it.
DeWitt is here the whole time. Jump scare.
She's like, I've got to go tell Adele, like, wait, you don't think she knows about it already, do you? And she just says, she does now.
She walks through the door, does a Five Nights at Freddy's jump scare, and she apparently also learned ethics this episode.
No, she's always had it. Remember, the dollhouse helps people.
Yeah, she does usually hold to that. Also, like, the weird...
Sorry, I need to get this out of my brain. Replace Adele with Darmon. They're not just telling stories, they're changing lives. Okay, continue. Jokes for no like, one.
What Topher uncovers is that on, like, the wish fulfillment day, they went, actually, in their records, Sierra went to go see the doctor who diagnosed her, but actually she went to see Nolan. But, like, who covered that up? They were running that. Like, Adele... And Whisk, Dr. Saunders were in charge of running that.
Well, I think
so. Who covered that up for themselves?
This was the old Dr. Saunders, not the current one.
No. What?
No, because remember, Dr. Saunders used to be a guy.
No, this was after.
No. Frank is talking about the episode Needs from season one.
Oh, I thought you were talking about like back a year ago.
No. I mean back.
No, I mean when Nolan the Predator,
okay, fair enough.
Yeah, was first introduced. Like Topher's like, see, the other proof I have that Nolan is behind all this is actually Sierra went to go visit Nolan and not Dr. Mikado.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, no shit. The dollhouse is so bad at everything they do.
So like, I guess the dollhouse just like covered up the fact she went to see Nolan from themselves. Adele's trick. It is Adele's trick. Shit. That's the only way this makes sense, because Adele seems not to know.
Adele's trick, so trick. I even tricked Adele. Me.
Anyway. Yeah. Sorry, I was a bit of a tangent. I just, like, a few minutes after that scene, I was like, wait. What? Wait, what's happening? Wait, this is key to this whole plot, and it's nothing.
But yeah, Adele summons Boyd. Nolan is beating around the bush in a weird way. It's like, we're not letting you, we're not enabling you anymore. And he goes, actually, I think you will continue to enable me. And she just doesn't say anything. And that's
She doesn't exactly beat around the bush, because she's like. He's like, but I guess you're here to talk to me about the repeat engagement clause and the thing and how I keep on doing the repeat engagement. And she's like, in a way, yes. And then she calls him a rapist and tries to like girl boss him, but then he gaslights and gatekeeps her.
Which like, and she's like, we're not going to enable you anymore. Adele, you're a rapist enabler. That's what you do. That's your job. Huh? You don't get to take a high ground here. You're a rape peddler.
She goes up to him and says, "You have made me an accomplice in something horrible." Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, and that's where I wrote, "But is the dollhouse bad?"
I just wrote, "Oh my god, is this your line that you won't cross?" Like, what? Why?
I'll be a madam, but I won't be a, but I won't be a raper.
I feel like this is a good time to show this cast photo of Adele just standing very girl bossily.
Yeah, and she does her whole thing where she's like, "I wouldn't let you near any of our actives any sooner than I let a mad dog near a child, considering you're a rapist and a borderline murderer. I forget, do you take your coffee with sugar?" Which is the kind of thing that, like,
yeah, no, that was
this show thinks is cool.
Yeah, that's a Whedon line right there.
Yeah,
that's a very Whedon, "I'm sticking it to you" sort of thing. But he gaslights and gatekeeps her by saying, mm-hmm. "Actually, I think we are going to yeah. sidestep this little repeat thing because you're just going to print Sierra and give her to me forever."
And yeah, because I'm rich enough and connected enough, you have no choice.
And if you do that, I'll make sure that you keep, I'll see about you keeping your job. Which is then followed up by Mr. Rossum Man. His name is not Mr. Rossum, but I always think of him as Mr. Guy from Rossum. So
how could you remember such a memorable name? Not remember Mr. Harding.
Is that his name?
Yes.
Okay.
So also this is this is kind of a complicated thing because I don't actually sympathize with Adele. She's a monster. But the way the show presents both her talking to Nolan and then her talking Mr. It's Rossum like Man is like she stands up for what she believes in and refuses to do the poor thing and then is forced by the system to do it anyway. And then there's like, a lot of lingering shots on her looking like really fucking upset.
As if she's being forced to hold a child underneath a running bath. Like,
yes, it's
even the fucking guy like calls her out on the spot and is like, "You literally were fucking Victor." Like,
and then he says, "But that's not even that we don't care. That's not even the least of your discretions. And you know it. I know it. We don't care."
The audience doesn't know it because that would require explaining anything.
It's just like if you need to pretend that you're more, like, he says something to the effect of, "If you need to pretend that you are doing something morally right to sleep at night, then by all means. But this is the dollhouse is owned by Rossum. It is, and it will be run the way we say it." So, print Sierra for a rapist. Anyway.
Speaking of Sierra, she and Victor get to have a tender moment in the shower. Awe and delight.
Yeah, okay, audience. But let's explain it because that sounds gross and weird, but it is actually a lot less gross and weird than it sounds.
I know this is hammering a point home, but she does, while talking to Mr. Rossum, say, you know, he's like, "What are we already?" You know, and she's like, "We're not slave merchants."
You kind of are.
Yes!
No, that's literally what you are!
Like, I can't think of a better term than that. That's explicitly it.
Like, yeah.
I understand that you got people to sign a contract sometimes in order to agree to do this, but that's still slavery.
Uh-huh.
If you want to refine it to, "Oh, we only do indentured servitude, not slavery," then
I have a very fun website for you. It's called Reddit, and I think you'll do very nicely there.
r/amitheasshole
Oh God, she would.
Please help my actives have unionized.
Very good.
But yeah, I feel very gross giving the show a compliment. It does not deserve it. I did like the scene with him.
I was okay with it up until a point where I wasn't un-okay with it, but okay. I was just like, oh, come on, this is stupid.
I was okay with it. I liked it.
And then the racism happened for a moment, and I went,
Yeah, oh, there was also that. Okay, so this scene, I'll just describe it, then we can talk about it. This scene Victor is in the shower, but fully clothed, because he's rinsing out the black paint pots. And Sierra comes in and is like, what are you doing? And he was like, you don't like this color, so now you don't have to use it anymore. And she's like, aw. And then she, like, kind of smears some paint, and then she's like, oh. And then she starts finger painting Victor's face in the shower, and he does it back, and they just sort of, like, smile, and they're laughing, and they're just like, ha, 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 ha. And then he says, you look like an Indian chief. No, she says, you look like an Indian chief. And he says, I am an Indian chief. And then they go, ha, 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 ha. And then Victor flashes back to the war.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then Victor flashes back to, Sarge, they're coming, what do we do?
Because she has black face paint markings that are similar to the, like, camouflage face paint that this guy, that the army people had when he was in this army.
And he crumples to the ground and he goes, I don't want to take charge.
Yeah, which this, you at home may not even remember this, but we previously saw this, I think, exactly once before.
There was a vague allusion to the fact that Victor's trauma from his past has to do with being in a terrible, like, armed forces situation.
It's a surprise plot tool we use later.
And it, which is, apparently now suggested to be some situation where he was technically in charge and people, and one would assume people died, because he had no idea what to do. But, like, he's just crumpled there, and it's like, what is, okay, come on, Dollhouse, you had something very minor going, and it was like, all right, whatever, okay, well, okay, you could stop with the racism, oh, wait, what just happened? What?
Call of Duty.
Why is this happening?
It's a 1-2 punch of why is this happening, where it's like, wait, why did you write you look like an Indian chief? And then immediately, like, oh, wait, why are we doing the gritty flashback for Victor? That's not what this is about.
Because, like, I guess apparently we need to know that Victor's wounded or something, and so he needs her?
Yeah, I think that's also what it is, to show, like, it's not just Victor looking out for Sierra. Sierra looks out for Victor.
Which, like, we don't need it. Especially we don't need it right now, because it's not the emotional crux of your episode, Dollhouse. The emotional crux of your episode, Dollhouse, is this weird through line of Victor and Sierra, no matter where they go, no matter what time they find themselves in, they meet each other and rekindle and grow into love. Like, sorry, I'm just thinking about one of those stupid stories where it's like, we met throughout many times throughout time, and, like, and fell in love every time. Like, that's what apparently they're doing. Also, Sierra is being mega raped constantly, which is fun to remind us. Thanks, Dollhouse. But, like, you're not actually doing anything by dropping another Victor hint here. We don't need it. It's a disservice to whatever story you're trying to tell with him. It's a disservice to whatever story you're trying to tell with Sierra. It's bad. And you stepped halfway into something almost poignant, and then just sort of, like, just took your other foot and stamped in some shit and smeared it around.
Speaking of stamping in some shit,
the next scene is it's Adele and Topher. This is where she's like, look, we hire everybody at the Dollhouse because there's something wrong with them. But because you have no morals.
It's such a fucking, it's another little bait and switch, because she's like, everyone here was chosen because their morals were compromised. Except you. And he's like, what? You, Topher, were chosen because you have no morals. And then it's like, oh, what? And she's like, and she, like, talks about how you think of them all as your little toys, and you can't, like, so you care about them when they're hurt, but really you only see them as objects that you play with. And it's like, yeah, we know. Why are you telling him this, Adele?
She's telling us, the audience, this entirely so that Topher can prove that he actually has morals after
all. Yeah, the whole time Topher's, like, looking, like, hurt, confused, as if he didn't realize it.
I came here to have a good time. And I'm just feeling really attacked right now.
As a certain site we've all know and love would say, Topher's quite a wooby in this episode.
He is, though. Literally, because that is a fucking Whedon, that's a fucking Whedon thing. He is absolutely. And this is what I wanted to fucking touch on. This fucking aggravating Topher redemption arc that I knew was going to happen, but I still didn't want it to happen. And I hate that I have to watch it now. That I have to watch it in the middle of the Sierra is getting mega raped all of the time plotline. Why is it Topher's redemption?
I mean, I like how you're talking about it like it's over with this episode.
No, this is only the fucking midpoint.
If there's a through line for character development in this show, you could argue that it's Echo gradually coming to learn stuff, but that's not really development, it's just changing. The character who's developing the most throughout this show is Topher.
Yeah, because just like in every other fucking Joss Whedon show, the awkward background nerdy guy is the one that we get way more internal life from than we ever needed. And it's really fucking great that the episode that it's that's plot line is about a woman named Priya who is fucking like preyed on and drugged and locked up, has her mind erased, has to fucking relive this made up fantasy dream of fucking her rapist again and again and again, is the episode where we get to figure out that Topher has feelings.
Yeah. Hey, what shot started this episode?
Topher!
Yeah, it was Topher.
Topher's fucking feelings!
Topher looking devastated and saying he was just trying to help was the first shot we get.
This is all about redeeming Topher for a thing we didn't know he did.
Yeah. That is also terrible, even if we find out, we're supposed to find out, it was actually terrible because she wasn't really crazy. But it would have been terrible if she was schizophrenic also. It's just bad. Hey, he's a monster.
Can we add a meta-narrative ding, please?
Yeah.
I guess I'll put that under other. I don't know, other.
Yeah, I'd say other because
it's special kind of ding in an episode that's supposed to be predominantly about a female character's struggle.
Yeah, and where it creates a fabricated mental illness in her to fix her with as a dramatic sticking point for a man.
Yeah, it's a good point.
Let's talk about Boyd for a second.
Boyd, what the hell?
Because this is when Boyd goes to So Adele calls Boyd and is like, okay, I think Topher's developing emotions.
A conscience.
Topher, ironically, is becoming compromised by morals. I need you to make sure he does this. And Boyd says, okay, let me just finish poking through another woman's property first. And by that I mean he's, like, knee-deep in Echo's sleeping pod. Is the fact that he finds a book supposed to be what's...
We didn't mention this. Yeah, earlier there was a book she was reading.
And he
was
noticed
like, huh.
It. And that made him go, huh. So he decided to investigate further, which, hey, guess what? This is something that any of them were supposed to be doing at any given point, considering their fucking mission objective. But, like, he's, like, digging through her sleep pod because apparently in the little recess that where like the glass pulls away or something, she's hidden the book that she was reading on the dollhouse floor.
She
picked a leaf off of a plant and put it, and it turns out she put it in the book for a bookmark. To which he says, so she can remember.
But this is when he gets the call.
He
leaves, and the...
He just drops it!
Yeah. Well, no, he think he keeps the book.
No, he takes the book.
No, I mean, he just drops the subject.
Oh, yeah. Oh. And this is when we get probably the most insane shot in the entire episode.
Yes.
The glass...
So he's taken the book from the sleeping coffin.
Yeah.
Damn.
But the glass that covers their sleeping pods, slides back.
Yeah, it closes, and Jesus!
And she has etched a message into the glass to help her remember.
To help her remember every fucking plotline of every episode!
Yeah, it's just like, you know, it's like a crazy person,
it is,
like,
it is literally,
scroll.
I gave you all the clues, Mr. Officer level writing.
I said this earlier. This is potentially what I would write down for notes for each one. Okay, so there's the one where like her son killed her. There was the one where she's like a fucking like super Christian. There's the one where she was,
oh yeah, I have the transcript here.
Oh yeah.
So there are two lines of text. I will start with the left, move to the right. The attic is bad. I was trained to kill. My son killed me. I am a believer. I have a right to survive. My husband bought me a house. Blue skies. I love my baby. The baby isn't mine. It's supposed to say, I like pain, but they wrote it badly so it looks like it says, I like pan. women are whores. That one they got clear. It's supposed to say, I tried to make shade, but they wrote it wrong, so it looks like I tried to make shape.
Yeah, I read it as, I tried to make shape, and I was like,
it's supposed to be a D, but they fucked it up.
Mm.
The right one, we only get part of it, because it's, you know, zoomed in. Where is Caroline? I am nobody. Friends help each other. I was blind. Shoulder to the wheel. Ghosts aren't. Mountains are safe. Topher makes me. Dominic was bad boy. November is. Victor loves Sierra. Sierra loves... That's it.
God, remember Shoulder to the Wheel? That saying? That was...
In one
of those episodes?
It was the fucking Most Dangerous Game episode.
That was episode two.
It was the catchphrase that her would-be murderer had.
Which means that she has been writing these for the whole show.
No, I think she's just been remembering them more recently and writing them to try and arrange them.
I mean, neither of those makes sense, but one of them has to be true.
I think it's like, oh, now that she's more recently awakened ever since, like, especially
Alpha did put all of her different personalities into her.
Yes, and since then she's been remembering them way more clearly.
Which is still... stupid. Even though they actually went out of the way to explain it, I would actually accept that she's been doing it the whole time more, because at the very least it'd be like, oh, okay, it's some weird callback to the fact that she's been like this basically since we started the show. But of course not.
Yay, Dollhouse.
We're only... Well, we're more than halfway through this. We're exactly halfway through this episode. I just looked at the timestamp of that scene.
The good news is that the back half of the episode is a lot more, like...
Yeah.
Well, the back half of the episode is where I hit, okay, 2x speed, let's go.
Yeah. The next scene is... there's some dings. It's... a flashback to the 90s, a year ago. I guess something happened to the old Sierra. Don't know what. But Adele says, oh, there's a 22-year-old paranoid schizophrenic. Topher, go get her.
And he's like, ooh, paranoid schizophrenic.
It is a mental health facility that we learn is run by Nolan.
It's run by Nolan, but, like, a different doctor is, her, the one that diagnosed her.
Yeah.
And he's
the doctor, Makito, or whatever, the one that they thought that she went and confronted, but didn't
actually. Yeah, that thing that they made up, right.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, but basically, it's one massive staged setup to, I guess, make it look real enough that the dollhouse, and by extension Topher, goes, yep, seems legit.
I assume that Nolan's been drugging her, because he's, like, personally working on her, on Priya's case here.
Yeah.
And, like, so I assume that no one else in the hospital knows, but I don't know. It doesn't actually matter. I don't know why
they don't
I said
actually
this.
Say. They don't say anything yeah. about any of that. It's just that Nolan is vaguely there, and Priya is talking like she's on fucking Law and Order.
Yeah. Yeah, Priya's doing a really great job of acting like a crazy person on a TV show.
Yeah.
It's good, and I like watching it.
Boy, the 90s and mid-2000s were really great about mental health, huh?
Hey, Rain Man was fun, right? What about Forrest Gump? Academy Awards, everybody! Woo!
But yeah, Topher, I guess, believes that he's helping her, and is like, yep, well, let's take you to the dollhouse. This won't. I am Topher. I don't know what goes on at the dollhouse, I guess. Question mark.
I mean, at this point, it's like, how long have you been here? Wait, why are you going here to... What? I guess it's because you're the brain guy,
Yeah, I was gonna say, maybe it's so that, like, he can see them beforehand and go, yeah, we can work with that, or no, we can't work with that, or something like that.
Maybe.
Yeah, I guess. I don't understand why this is anything.
Adele's trick. Like, Adele's trick. She didn't
Adele's trick.
Funny.
It's Adele's trick.
Like, again, much like that charity case they did a while back for no reason at all. Why are they picking a random schizophrenic to be an active quote-unquote charity? Like, why do they do that?
Well, in this case, I would imagine it's because Nolan contacted them.
Right, but, like, Adele doesn't...
Oh, because Adele is a no, fucking...
Well, okay, yeah. the thing with Nolan is he's like a doctor. He's specifically like he specializes in mental illness drugs.
Yeah, he's a neuromicrobiologist. He is apparently very, very well renowned in the global world, level.
But he's also an executive of RASA. Like
extremely important to the RASA Corporation.
So it is literally a case of the calls coming from inside the house.
In
this.
Some ways that you might even suggest to yourself, oh, did he come up with the dollhouse stuff?
But yeah, from this we move to the present, where Sierra is getting imprinted. There's like a scene where it's Topher that like retrieves her, mm-hmm. and is like, okay, are you ready for your treatment?
By the way, ding for her getting pulled away while like screaming and raving, like, I'm a prisoner, I'm...
They're poisoning me!
This is where the song plays! This is where the song...
Oh, yeah, right, of course it is!
Yeah, as they're grabbing her, and she's kicking and screaming and through the parking lot, and...
The song, by the way, is titled Drones.
Is it?
Yep, so the subtitles have told.
Oh, because the subtitles told gave me a different name.
Yes.
Oh.
I got Wanderer Girl or whatever it was.
Oh yeah, no. At the start of the thing, in parentheses, it says Drones.
No, Drones is the name of the song. I don't know why.
Weird.
But yeah, we get a scene where Victor tries to go with her to the imprint. And Topher's like, no, you stay here. She'll be back soon.
To be clear, listener, what we mean to say is that we are cutting back and forth. Mm-hmm. Because this is happening in the present, because Topher has to give Sierra the perma rape imprint. But also we're like watching how he took her in to begin with, and it's supposed to be like fucking deep or something.
Mm-hmm. And the whole time there's this indie rock song, like very slow, gentle. Like there's a xylophone. It's mostly xylophone, I think. Well, I guess so, Jed Whedon is singing.
Yes, it is Jed Whedon singing.
Fuck,
listener, I'm gonna make it make sense. Imagine this is Life is Strange, and a song is playing at the start of an episode. Jokes for neither of you two, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Sorry.
But honestly, I think a lot of people listening, it probably is for them. So, yeah.
Victor stays where he is told to for the rest of the fucking episode.
He literally says, "I'll wait here," and then he just sort of sits in that spot. And it's like, well, of course, okay, that makes sense. But it's like funny active joke for this scene. Okay, why?
While this is happening, Boyd confronts Echo, because I guess this is a great time to have this happen.
It is because of how he acts, actually.
Can I just say some of the lyrics to the song, seemingly the chorus? We're drones, happy as we are, thinking our sustain lies in love, which is shown as Sierra imprinted as a loving girlfriend is walking into Nolan's place, probably presumably for the first of many engagements.
Can we get a rival dollhouse called the Beehive? Anyway. I guess it's the fact that she was using a bookmark and he saw her grab the leaf, which is why he's confronting Echo. But
yeah, I guess, which is like, I mean, the fact that she's reading a book that you found is enough to be like, okay, I should probably be looking further into this, as you know, as we are an evil corporation.
She tries to like shrug it off, and he's like, "Oh, who taught you how to lie?" I guess he's cool with it for some reason.
Like, he's just like, he's just like, some people wouldn't take too kindly to this.
Mm-hmm. But I don't give a shit. Why? I don't know.
Whatever. Adele's trick. She hired me.
God. What was I also going to say? Her response to him, like, she drops the act and says, a storm is coming and I want them to wake up because everyone needs to survive.
And because she's like, I want to wake everyone. Some of them aren't ready to wake up. And she's like, I don't care. A storm is coming. Huh?
Yeah, and Boyd has just decided that she's like a weird mastermind, and like, what storm? Like, we know a storm is coming because of the way a TV show works, but like, there's no reason to think that.
They know a storm is coming. Did they forget what happened with Alpha? I mean,
I think what she's referring to is actually the post-apocalyptic future we saw in the weird spinoff episode of season 1.
Was the spinoff episode Echo having a brain blast of the future?
That's why it wasn't totally accurate. She's not a perfect oracle, but she is. But she can see it a little bit.
It's an echo from the future.
Oh, no! I'll bet that was the name of one of the graphic novels.
Ugh. I can't wait to read those.
Oh boy. This is also where we get a twist that is, not only has Topher developed a conscience, he's also grown a spine, I guess.
I guess?
Because he does the imprint with Sierra, but it's revealed to us, the viewer, that he actually just put her original mind back in her, rather than one of the countless sex bot ones.
Which I don't know who exactly it was supposed to begin with.
No,
it doesn't seem like Nolan knows which one imprint he wanted either.
No one ever makes that clear. He just wanted wife Sierra. I don't think he cared, honestly. Like,
he probably didn't. I'm just very, what was the, like, because Adele just gave vague orders and then gave even vaguer orders to Boyd.
The thing is when you see the photos of her, of Sierra in the drawer, all of them have different outfits.
Yeah.
Some of them are, like, party girl. One of them looks like barely legal teen.
Oh, sure. And like, I don't think he gives a shit. It's just, like, it's a very confusing thing to leave hanging for your audience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess about for a year, again, a year, he's done, like, 40 engagements with her, which must be really hard to fit around her schedule.
That
kind of
makes sense. Once a week, and someone like him would do it.
Yeah, I guess. It just must be hard to fit that in around her schedule of sitting in a house doing nothing to be Echo's best friend.
Oh, no, what we didn't see was on the other end of the nothing was him.
Yeah, oh, so she was Echo's best friend. Yeah, but also, oh, that makes sense. Yeah, you know. Hey, can we charge you a half rate for this week? We kind of might need
to. Yeah, sure, whatever. What do I care? I own this place.
Well, what if we just left the imprint in from the last job? Would they be cool with that?
I was like, I couldn't understand for the life of me why they were showing us that it was Priya's original whatever, because I was like, why not just give her killer powers or something?
Because it's implied that in doing so, Topher has also explained the deal to her.
Yeah, and he's like, and now you're free to do what you want. And she does say later,
on a higher narrative level, it is supposed to be making him fucking more like morally good and right, because it's like, I wish I was stronger enough to do more, but at least this time I was letting her make her own choices.
He could have at least, like, imprinted her with combat powers even on her default.
Yeah.
Hey, wait a minute!
That's what I thought!
I know I'm going back to the same well as I often do. If they thought that she was, like, insanely schizophrenic and you know, barely functional, well, how come when they did needs and she was normal, they didn't go, huh?
Well, you see,
'cause she wasn't schizophrenic in that episode. They saw that.
Well, I mean, I'm guessing that Topher is just like, well, obviously I didn't imprint the schizophrenia with personality. Why would I do that?
That would be gross. Although, we're all ignoring the most obvious answer.
The writers forgot?
No. Adele's trick.
Oh, right. Yeah, that too.
Anyway,
we get one, like, long extended scene here at Nolan's place. He still has her fucking painting up, which, of course, he does, but ugh. Okay. She drops the act, like, immediately. Like, she doesn't even fucking
literally walk up to the dinner table first thing, and then she's just like, oh, how do you want me? Smart or stupid? Like, you want me to talk at all? And then, no, seriously, how do you want me?
Yeah, and then she, like, gives him a little headbang on the chair, which, I guess, makes up for what's about to happen.
Yeah, no, she gets to be in power for, like, very lightly in power for about 5 seconds in order to counterbalance the next scene.
Where Nolan just starts beating the shit out of her.
At first he's like, of course, they have exactly the conversation you expect them to have, where he's like, oh, you came to get revenge for giving you a great year where you loved me?
And she's like, did I love you? I'm actually a great guy. I don't even remember it. Couldn't have been that good.
Mm-hmm.
Damn, girl.
I will say, she does say... Yeah. She does remember Victor. Because of the power of love. She doesn't remember who Victor is.
Just that,
but she remembers...
She remembers that she fell in love with some guy.
Yeah.
I'll figure... Not important. We'll find him later.
Yeah, but then she starts talking about it, and he's like, see? You did fall for me! What was that? Sorry, Gaston. What are you saying? Why are you talking like a villain? You're talking as stupid as a villain from a Disney movie. Like, what? It was also she could say, oh, no, not you. So she
yeah.
could, So he could be, like, mega enraged by her, you know.
Well, yeah, because we have to get to the physical abuse portion of this episode.
Yeah, we do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so then, of course, because she's just standing in front of the guy, he just starts beating the shit out of her really brutally.
And then we
can hear the dings coming from...
And he grabs her and, like, holds her down and is like, oh, I never even thought of that. I never even thought of this. This struggle is turn on.
Yeah, I never thought of you resisting.
Thanks, Joss!
Yay! Feminism!
Struggle is
a
turn on.
Yeah, no, it's shot like it's supposed to be a fight scene, sort of, but it's him just beating the shit out of her and her getting the shit beaten out of her.
Yep.
And menaced and threatened, and then a knife is involved at some point.
And then, like, she fights back just enough that he drops the knife and she grabs it and... Yeah. It's not actually that interesting.
No.
But she basically, in a matter of luck, after a couple minutes of getting abused, stabs him. Which, of course, while he's getting stabbed, we just get brief shots of him being in pain and some blood, but we mostly look at Priya's face.
Yeah.
As she's sobbing while stabbing
him. Sobbing
and,
like, breaking apart.
So it's not even like, oh, she gets to be whatever. It's like, no, she's still broken.
Feminism.
And in fact, she stabs the knife in a final time, and there's a shot where we just see her back off, and we're looking at her from Nolan's point of view, even though he's dead. And then, like, she's just sitting there looking, like, all broken, and then it cuts to her painting. It's like, yo, remember who
it cuts to her painting, and her shadow is looming over the painting, and the bird is just there. The dark figure is herself?
Looks at the camera. Do you get it? Do you understand?
Yeah, because, see, remember when she was painting dark figures? Well, now she's the dark figure, because she did a murder, and that makes you broken. If you murder your abuser, you're basically broken forever. That's what the remaining 10 minutes of this episode are about,
Well, no, the remaining 10 minutes of this episode are also Topher gets his nose rubbed in the mess he's made.
Oh,
like a
but
dog.
Yeah. also, like, Boyd reveals that he's from, like, I don't know, Boyd reveals that he's from, like, fucking Dexter or something.
Oh, yeah, that does happen.
No.
Yeah.
Like, because, like, we always knew from, like, early episodes that Boyd is, like, an ex-cop. But,
yeah,
like, that's mm-hmm. that doesn't prepare you for, here's how you deal with a dead body.
Yeah, so, Topher turns up at the fucking mansion to help
he gets
Priya
a phone
escape.
Call.
He gets a phone call?
Yeah.
Oh, does she call him?
It's a far away shot. We see Topher
right.
in his office.
He gets a random phone call. We don't know what it's about, and he's just like,
I think it's, I think we assume it's supposed to be Priya calling him, but I think it might also be Boyd. It doesn't actually matter. The point is he gets a phone call and goes.
Yeah, and then he shows up to, like, tell her, okay, we gotta go, we gotta move, you gotta run, you need to get out of here before somebody shows up. Gulp. And it turns out it's Boyd.
Oh yeah, and she's like, Priya/Sierra is of course crouched in a closet, like huddled up in the fetal position, like. Oh, God.
Oh, no. Are they going to put me back in the box?
But, yeah, so they're like, we got to get out, because Topher sees Nolan's dead body also. Gulp, someone's here.
And Boyd is like, I'm the head of... And he's like, Boyd, how did you know? I'm the head of security. I can listen to every call. And it's like, okay, so, A, yes... And that is even correct. It is something that I have been demanding of the head of security for the entire show. But B, bullshit. No, you didn't.
I can. I usually don't because I don't care about this job.
But, like,
but I could have.
But, like, yeah, he shows up, and he's like, well, now, and Topher's just like, well, what are we gonna do? And he's like, and he's just like, what's going on? And he's like, consequences. And then he's like, has Topher fucking dissolve the body in the fucking bathtub? so that they can, like, they cut him up. They cut, the boy just is like, you need to cut up his body so it'll burn down faster. You need to do this and this. And then he's like, he makes a, and like.
He calls someone that's implied to be like an ex, one of his friends.
Oh, I was getting to that. But like, because, but as they are doing this thing, we are also sorry, watching Priya, like, wander wounded and frightened and confused through the mansion up to the drawer where all of the pictures that he took of her are.
Hey, so I just want to, spoilers for the first couple episodes of Breaking Bad, I guess. Something just occurred to me that I kind of thought at the time, but I looked it up. The second episode of Breaking Bad, where they have to dissolve a body in acid, came out a year before this episode did. So, I was thinking, like, man, they're really Breaking Bad him. And if Breaking Bad had come out a little earlier, I would have accused them of just ripping off Breaking Bad with this scene.
But then I was like, wait.
Then I thought about it and I was like, oh, right. Dollhouse didn't actually come out in the 90s. It was 2009. And that, yeah, indeed. No. Yeah, so they do the scene where they chop up the body.
Absolutely. I thought it was important to know that we are flashing back and forth between Topher's harrowing journey having to dissolve a body, what? And Priya getting to yet again discover more of the constant rape abuse that she has been under while it's all happening. And I don't know why these are juxtaposed. It's just so we can watch her be traumatized more. So ding.
Yay.
So sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. It's just I know that this part happens before that part. So go ahead and please tell us. Who does Boyd call?
Well, it seems to just be like a friend of the when he was an officer. It's implied that this is not the first time he's had to dispose of a body.
Right. He's running through the situation very...
Boyd is really menacing this episode. Is this intentional or
I think the idea is, like, we're learning all sorts of things about people, our characters we didn't know, including, as a surprise, we learn that Boyd is darker than we ever suspected.
Now, I was waiting for this, actually, because... Not because I had some insight on whatever, but because earlier in the episode, when Adele says everybody in the dollhouse was hired because they had compromised, their morals or something.
We're all kind of sick and twisted here.
Yeah, yes, exactly. You don't have to be crazy to work here, but it helps. just kidding, we'd never allow that. That's gross. But like, she mentioned that, and it's like, oh yeah, Boyd. Because he's, like, the only other person who works there!
Yeah. Yeah, everyone... Wait, does that mean the fashion guy we saw last episode is also compromised? What did he do?
Well, she took a look at
his... Murdered my last three lovers. It was fabulous. I was on a Ryan Murphy show. Oh, okay, yeah, no, you belong here.
Oh, damn, yeah, no.
I like to imagine it's a similar situation of that legitimately real story where RuPaul said they watched a person drowning and did nothing to help them.
Oh.
This is a real story. RuPaul has talked about it in interviews. It's like, yeah, I saw them in the water. I don't know how they were doing. But I thought, I'll pray for them. And then I kept walking. It's insane.
Yeah.
Things you would never admit. Anyway,
a lot of things that RuPaul said that are things that you'd never admit, but for some reason they just keep tumbling out of her mouth. His mouth.
What about the... Sorry, I'm just, like, now that you've brought it up, like, the spa people? Are they compromised? Are they evil spawn people?
That one weirdo in the vaguely Chinese New Age medicine-y outfit that's just sort of there to give band-aids for boo-boos while Dr. Saunders is away?
Adelta took one look and went, ooh, racism, you'll do.
He's like, I'd like to apply to work. She's like, I don't know if you have the right. He's like, I'm a chiropractor.
And then he says,
Oh, okay, yes.
And then he says, oh, hold on. I meant to open with a joke. It'll be really funny. And then he pulls his eyes back and she's like, you're in.
Look, we all have been talking about how bad the dollhouse is, but have we never asked, maybe these actives just have really bad vibes? In any case, Boyd also calls Adele and is like, yeah, haha, he ran for the border, smiley face.
Yeah, because... Don't worry about it. Okay, sorry, no, I thought you were going to say this part, but when Boyd calls his friend, he says, I'm going to need the goose.
Yeah, it's been a while. I need the goose.
Someone disappeared. And I'm like, the goose? Who's the goose? The goose.
Please make the goose show up in a later episode. I really...
Why does Boyd's backstory include somebody who goes by the goose?
It's the goose from Untitled Goose Game. This is,
I need the goose.
Honk. I need the goose. Honk. Drag the body without being seen.
Oh yeah, but then, Boyd calls Adele. Sorry again.
He's very like vague about it, and it's really obvious. Like, it's supposed to be like, ooh, does she know what really happened? But it's really fucking obvious. She knows exactly what happened.
Like, except does she? Because like the way that she sits there afterwards is just like, well, that's done.
She has, like, almost a sly smile, and if it were a better show, I'd say they were supposed to be leaving us, like, maybe she knows, maybe she doesn't. And, like, the smile is almost not there, but because it's not a very good show, I don't think that's intentional. But she does smile, so I think she's supposed to figure it out herself, like, because she's like, how convenient.
Adele's trick.
Adele's trick.
I think she's supposed to know. But it doesn't
also, I'm sorry,
actually matter.
I mistook the song. Because I was actually thinking of the song from the end of the show.
No, I'm pretty sure that's just a license.
Traveling Woman.
Yes.
If we get a scene, if this was in a different show, I would like this scene. But it's this show, so I hate this scene. This is the one, like, this is after the cleanup presumably happens, because we're never going to follow up on this shit again. It's Priya and Topher sitting on a couch in Topher's office, drinking a beer together.
Topher's just like, I'm sorry, is there anything I can do to help? And she's like, you got a beer? And they just sort of sit down and she has a beer. Topher does not. He's too much of a baby. He can't have a beer. Mm-hmm. He's not old enough yet.
Well, no, they're just saving it for the Topher gets drunk episode.
Why would you say that to me?
Because I like speaking evil into the world. And again, like, if this was a different show and these were characters I liked, I would like this idea of, like, character who realizes just how deeply they fucked up and victim have a heart-to-heart where they find some kind of, like, not a common ground, but, like, just some kind of resolution.
But to be clear, the way the show frames this, the fuck-up was not, I took away all your autonomy and made you into a mind-wiped slave under false pretenses, even though the real pretenses would still be horrific. The show frames it as, oh, sorry, I was trying to help you escape, but instead I made you do a murder on your abuser, and now you're ruined forever.
But, no, because they, I do think that they take it one step further in the meta, which is just, I'm sorry, I was trying to help you escape your bad situation, but I also dragged you into a dollhouse to do a murder. So really, they think that they're being clever to like have him apologize in a way that covers both, but actually, it just highlights how stupid they are because. The two things that he feels at fault for are effectively the same thing.
Victor is still sitting there, by the way. He's
sitting in the same place that
he was pretty
earlier.
Funny.
But, like, she sees him, and she's like, oh shit, that's him. And, like, she looks back at, and is like, does my love for him, is that real? And Topher's like, yeah.
Which is, like, honestly, the only thing he's ever said that I've been like, that's probably a correct assessment to say, because despite how considerably asinine it is, it's true somehow that these two have managed to develop love feelings for each other despite being constantly brain blasted every other fucking episode. Not every episode, because they're only around for one at a, and they're only around usually one at a time.
I would argue it is like the one singular naturally generated thing that the Dollhouse has ever produced. Ever.
Yeah.
Is these two fell in love.
Except they apparently did it. Although they did apparently do it before she was even drugged and put in, because she started falling for him at the party.
Yeah.
I mean, in that case, she just saw him and saw a puppy dog looking man and went, okay.
Yeah, no, like, I feel like they were really playing into the stuff that they usually do when they're like, Sierra vaguely remembers that she loves Victor. And it's like, but wait, this is before and... Oh, huh? I don't know. It's just very weird. It's all very weird to me. This show is weird.
Also, it is worth noting that Topher's still kind of lying to her, because I only remember one. I think he says two things, but one, when she's like, are we allowed to have beer in here, or do we not do that? Like, asking, like, do the actives ever have beer in this dollhouse? And he says, oh, sometimes on special occasions, which is like, no, they wouldn't have beer. Actives don't have beer.
Yeah, no, that would be way too much for them. They would have maybe pureed lettuce.
They would expire like a Victorian child if they had a beer.
Yeah, so it's like, it would be the most distilled of waters and an extra leaf of lettuce.
So yeah, he's still kind of lying. I mean, I know it's presented as like, oh, you know, he's just trying to make her feel better about what's going to happen.
Ever
because
been doing.
Yeah, like he's gonna wipe her. Is the because he has to because she doesn't have any other place to be.
Yeah, but she knows that, and she's like, like she's very blasé about it.
Well, she does eventually like consent to it on the condition that she's like, you know, at the end of this, don't. Give me back the memory.
Well, she says, if you ever wake me up again. She accounts for the idea that he may not even do that, but yes, she says, just promise me, just delete this day. I want it to be like it never happened. I don't want to wake up to that. Which, like, no shit you don't, but, like, fuck! Fuck!
Yeah, like, I get that it's traumatic to kill somebody. I don't want to downplay that necessarily. But it's really viewed as, like, her killing him really has made her totally broken as a person. Indelibly, it has ruined her.
And Topher's going to fix that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah
but,
he
like,
wants
it's okay.
Try to help.
But but it's okay now, because she says so. Girl power, Joss Whedon feminism, woo.
Yippee.
Yay.
Yeah. Then he wipes her. No fanfare.
And he just kind of wipes her, and she's like, did I fall asleep? Anyway, there is still one more scene.
Yep.
She does also, right before she gets wiped, she's also like, the secret we have, of her killing people, can you keep it? And he says, like, Topher says, I can keep it, but I don't know if I can live with it. And she says, I don't know if I can live with it, but I don't have to. Looking at him as if he's the victim
yes!
here.
Yes!
I just have to point that out. Like, I don't have to live with this terrible secret, but you do.
It's you actually poor man, Topher. Perhaps you have been traumatized most of all. You, who people think didn't even have morals, but really you're just a sweet little wooby baby man. Fuck.
Sorry, I just had to say that before we cut the final scene.
The final scene, which is... They're all in the same pod room, right?
Yes, but I think that's revealed. Topher Blank Sierra, traveling woman, plays, and we end up in Echo's pod chamber, where she's pulling out her book, and she opens the book. And there's a big old message written just like the big old message that Dr. Saunders got that says, "For the storm." And there's a master key card just like in the book.
Yeah.
Yep.
So Boyd's just like, yeah, sure. I don't like my job. Which, hey, honestly, I can respect it,
Boyd's
I guess.
Just like, hey, well, you know, maybe I want Boyd's trick. You know, I don't know. And then it sort of zooms out and we get a full shot and Sierra and Victor are sleeping in the same pod together?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Because they love each other.
Somehow.
Just throughout this whole episode it's become, I haven't really said it because we were focused on other things, but just the fact that so many times throughout this episode, all three of our main actives here just kind of do whatever. Echo walks into the lab. Victor and Sierra are just spending time together and, like, painting each other in the showers and sleeping together in the same thing. And,
look,
like, Victor's visibly pining for Sierra. Like, they just don't care anymore, look, right? Like, this whole place is fucking falling apart.
This couldn't happen in the show, but I really wish we would get an episode where it's a different, like, clique of three actors watching them and just, like, sulking to themselves and being like, I can't believe they get to do all the shit. Like, it couldn't happen.
Mike, no!
Yeah, but it would be so funny just to see, like, from another actor's perspective.
Dollhouse Lower Decks, yeah.
Yeah.
God damn it.
I hate that I would probably, like, I would hate watch it, but I would hate watch Dollhouse, but it's like Dollhouse Toronto or something. I don't know, like a different Dollhouse.
Dollhouse Miami.
Yeah, I was just going to say Dollhouse Miami.
Yes, could you?
Dollhouse.
No.
Nice.
No, imagine the Dollhouse, it's the exact same, but there's shitty palm trees everywhere inside the Dollhouse.
Ooh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like a big inflatable alligator.
Topher, but he's wearing a shitty, like, hot pink Miami Hawaiian shirt. Fuck. I want that because of how bad it would be.
Oh, it'd be so bad. And yet so good. It wouldn't be. It would still be this. Like, but honestly, I think we deserve something.
Look, if Heroes can get a reboot.
Fucking what?
Huh.
Yeah, they brought Heroes back at some point.
What?
Oh.
It Why? Was, I don't know. I don't watch Heroes. I just know that it got, like, a, like, extension rebrand.
Okay, Mix, like... I just want to say right now, you acted offended, like, I expected you to know that. But, like, all of the things that you've come to us knowing, like, how am I supposed to know that where you draw the line is Heroes?
You know, now that I say that, I remember I actually think I owned the first season somewhere, and I've just never opened the box. So, you're right. Criticism retracted.
Well, there's only one season of the reboot, so there you go. I just looked it up.
Was there anything else we wanted to talk about for this episode, or do we just want to wash our hands of this?
Oh, fuck! No, I think that's it. So,
I mean, you have your regular feature, right?
Yeah. So, like, what's everybody's like favorite, least favorite thing? What's the dumb, stupid thing from this episode that you like? Your favorite?
I am calling dibs on Jed Whedon singing a song.
Damn it, yeah, okay. I'll have to find something else. It's really funny that they're singing it. It's, we're drones, happy as we are. And it's just like,
give us a Dollhouse a musical episode, you cowards.
Oh my god, he wanted to. Like, that is absolutely something that he wanted to do. And I bet you that he fucking had one in mind, and he fucking just excavated it for Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog the next year.
Oh, boy. Oh, right, this was pre-first writer's strike, wasn't it?
Yep, although you wouldn't know it.
Well.
I have two? One is just that everybody... Like, on three separate occasions, someone is just behind everyone in the lab. Like, by surprise. And I don't understand how that happens.
They're all using the back rooms.
I guess Adele was in the back rooms, and Echo was in the back rooms, and Echo was in the back rooms again. Why is it people keep showing up in the fucking lab? They should lock those doors. But I guess my real one is probably, just Victor sitting there, being told, like, about 10 minutes into the episode, like, hey, I'll be back soon. And he says, I'll wait here for you. And everyone's like, okay. And then he just sits there for an entire day.
Because he is literally a stupid little puppy dog.
Yeah, well, that's pretty good.
It's like this legend called Hachiko in Japan. of the dog.
Oh my god. Imagining a statue of Victor sitting like a dog in front of his train station now.
For me, I think it's just that I really, really love that they just sort of slide in the fact that Adela's absolutely fucked other dolls before. Like, Victor's just the one she felt bad about.
You know, if anyone on Tumblr cared about the show seriously, they would be like, oh my god, what if she fucked a female active?
Oh, damn! She'd be a double girl boss!
Yeah, because there's two of them there.
Woo! Yeah, what if she fucked Echo?
Ooh. Okay, archive of her own.
No! But yeah, the deflated girl boss that was Adele in this episode. Shrinking. Oh, I'm sorry. No, okay, I take it back. There is one thing that tops it for me. The fact that when she's telling Topher that he needs to go ahead and permaprint Sierra, she's got this double scotch in a tumbler in her hand that she's just staring at and pouring, and I'm like, yeah, keep pouring. pour. Like, she's just, like, staring at it like she's been doing it all day. And it just, you know what? Adele's trick indeed. This show sucks.
This show sucks. I have a trick of my own.
Oh?
This involves the next episode.
What is it called?
The next episode is called The Public Eye. So, there is one thing I have known about Dollhouse Season 2 the whole time, because it is the only thing I ever saw anyone talk about when the show was airing live.
Oh, no.
I'm not going to say specifics. What I will say is, next episode, we get a new main character.
Fucking what?
And it's played by a well-known actor or actress from previous Joss Whedon work. Before this point.
Damn it!
It was actually, like, teased that somebody from a previous work would be coming to
Dollhouse. Oh my god,
Dollhouse.
A Joss Whedon Hail Mary.
Yeah. And all I will say is I do kind of know a little bit about what this character's deal is and their role in this show. Both of you are going to lose your fucking minds about this.
Oh.
It's Jonathan Frakes!
Surprise, I'm actually acting in this one.
No, I think it was the Dollhouse Wiki I was looking at noted when I clicked on Jonathan Frakes, directing this episode is his only credit with the show.
I mean, I would hope so.
Yeah. He got brought on and was like, well,
thanks for the paycheck.
Thanks for having me. Yeah.
So you have that to look forward to when we watch next week's episode.
Yeah.
Nice. Thanks.
Fuck Joss Great. Whedon.
Fuck Joss Whedon.
Fuck Joss Whedon.
Like a doll, like a puppet with no will at all. And somebody taught me how to talk, how to walk, how to walk.
Oh shit, I meant to say this somewhere. Here, I don't know, you can edit it in or not, because I don't think I said this on recording last time, I just said it to you in person, Michelle. But one thing about this season is, like, because it's more structured, more narrative, it's not better, it's probably worse, but there is much more of a sense for me of, like, I really do want to know what happens next. Like, whereas last season, because they were all, like, individual whatevers, it's like, I don't care where this is going, because I know how the season has to end, which is Echo becomes, like, realized or whatever, and Alpha shows up, and everything in between them doesn't matter. I'm not looking forward to any, but now it's like, I gotta know. The fuck are they gonna do next? So, I guess that is a thing about this season, is that it makes me want to watch it because it's worse.